Hello, good morning, church family. Our scripture verses today are Psalm 99, verses 1 through 5. The Lord reigns, let the peoples tremble. He sits enthroned upon the cherubim, let the earth quake. The Lord is great in Zion, he is exalted over all the peoples. Let them praise your great and awesome name. Holy is he. The king in his might loves justice. You have established equity. You have executed justice and righteousness in Jacob. Exalt the Lord our God. Worship at his footstool. Holy is he.
Exalt the Lord our God. Let's put that scripture into singing as we sing together. He is exalted, number 36 in our songbooks. Let's stand as we sing.
He is exalted, the King is exalted on high. I will praise him. He is exalted forever, exalted, and I will praise his name. He is the Lord, forever his truth shall reign. Heaven and earth rejoice in his holy name. He is exalted, the King is exalted on high.
Let's sing that again, great singing.
He is exalted, the King is exalted on high. I will praise him. He is exalted forever, exalted, and I will praise his name. He is the Lord forever. Truth shall reign, heaven and earth rejoice in his holy name. He is exalted, the King is exalted on high.
Amen. Amen. Now we're going to sing another song about exalting God, and it's number 32 in your songbooks, if you're not familiar with it. It says in Psalm 57, be exalted, O God, above the heavens. Let's sing together.
I will give thanks to thee, O Lord, among the people. I will sing praises to thee among the hedges. For thy steadfast love is great to the heavens. And thy faithfulness to the cloud. Be exalted, O God, above the heavens. Let thy glory be over all the earth. Be exalted, O God, above the heavens. Let thy glory be over all the earth.
Amen. Thank you, Lord, that you're above all nations and above all things. And we love you and exalt you this morning. Amen. Now turn to those around you and greet them in the love and the name of the Lord.
shouldn't have come up super early. That's fine. Happy Sunday, Torrance First Baptist. Yeah, this Sunday is just a typical Sunday, right? Nothing's going on today. As Pastor Jared said, we need to be present here, though, guys. Let's just be focused for like an hour and a half, and then we'll go to the wings and pizza in a second. Speaking of the Super Bowl, though, how many of you guys are rooting for the Eagles? And how many of you guys are rooting for Kansas City? How many of you guys don't even know what sport is being played today? We have some English people in the house. Football is the one where you throw it. Not none of that stuff, okay? Miss Nadine, I see you. That's football. I have a few announcements for you guys this morning. The first is, can someone raise up a connection card, please? Someone raise up a connection card. Connection card. Yeah, everyone. Okay, sweet. How many of you guys have not filled those out yet? Some. Okay. We would love your information, not to do anything creepy with your information, but so we can connect with you, stay connected with us. So please, if you have not filled that out, we would love, please do so. Next, we have the 40 days of life. Mr. Rick Sabalski, where are you at? Okay, so if you want more information on that, see that handsome gentleman with the glasses and the hair on the sides. I'm so sorry. I'm trying to like point you out, okay? Anyways, this might be the last time I do announcements. The pizza and wings are on my mind, I'm sorry. Next announcement, we got the Love One Another potluck. We do this every single year. Sunday, February 19th at 5 p.m. So how many of y'all have the last name A through F? Raise your hand. A through F. You're gonna bring a salad, so bring your favorite salad. G through L, if your last name's G through L, you're gonna bring a side dish. And then M through Z, last names, bring a main dish. On the count of three, everyone say what dish you're bringing. One, two, three. We're gonna have a lot of food and I'm excited. So, but it's a potluck, so you gotta come with it, okay? Don't just be, some of my kids are just like, can I just like not bring anything? I'm like, no, bring something, okay? So bring according to your last names. We have two more announcements. The first is that we got the men's breakfast. Where are my men at? It sounded like a dying dog. Let's try that one more time. Where are my men at? So we have hearty food and even heartier fellowship coming up on Saturday, March 11th at 8:30. So be there for that. And on the same day, we have our women. Where are my ladies at? We got our ladies' bunco night. In honor of St. Patty's Day, wear your green attire, okay? And it's also kind of like a potluck too, so bring your favorite appetizer and dessert to share, and there will be special prizes for the winner. That's Saturday, March 11th at 6 p.m. That's all the announcements I have. And worship. Can I worship? Pastor Raj. Oh, yes, Pastor Raj.
Good morning, everybody. We're going to have a special prayer for our earthquake victims, but some people are asking, why the colored shoes? When we went to the TM conference in the car, some of the guys were mentioning that maybe Pastor Raj needed to refresh his footwear. So I wanted everybody to know that even though I am the older pastor, I still am very young at heart. Voila. So. So Jeremy said, hey, I'll join you. So Jeremy put on his reds. And so we tried to get Jared. He doesn't have
a red thing on the back of my shoe. I wore a red
shirt. He can preach sitting down this morning. So seriously, we do want to pray for all of the dear ones in Turkey and in Syria. We all know that recently they had a 7.8 earthquake, if you can wrap your head around that, followed by a 7.5. What many people don't know is that since then they've had over 140 aftershocks of 4.0 or greater. And so they are still just reeling. This morning I looked up and there's 28,000 that have been confirmed dead, and there are thousands more that they fear are buried underneath the 500 buildings that have collapsed. So we want to be praying for them. And Pastor Jared has a dear friend who works over there, Turkish Connections International. And we are assured that whatever gift that we give will go 100% to ministering to the needs of these dear people. So call the church office if they need to TF and just tag it earthquake relief, and we will make sure that it gets to the right people and it will be used for their need and for God's glory. But let's pray for these dear people. Heavenly Father, we just come to you this morning. Our hearts ache. We know yours is broken over the loss of life and the damage that has been done. We pray for the dear families that have lost loved ones. We pray for those who are still looking for their families and hoping beyond hope that they're still alive. We pray for the government officials and all of those that are there to try to help these dear people. And we pray for this group, for Turkish Connections International and other ministry groups that are there on the ground seeking to be your hand and feet to these dear people. Father God, we ask your grace, your mercy, your blessing upon these dear people. And we pray that through it all, even though this has been so devastating, we pray that there would be many people there who would come to faith in the Lord Jesus, seeing your people ministering in your name to them. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let's continue our worship. No matter what's going on around us, that God is still holy. Is he not? You can stand with us as we sing. Joy of the Lord is our strength. We bow down and worship him now. How great, how awesome is he. Together we sing. Everyone sing. Holy is the Lord God Almighty. The earth glory, holy is Lord God Almighty. The earth is filled with His glory. Oh, the earth is filled with His glory. We stand and lift up our hands for the joy of the Lord is our strength. We bow down. Everyone changed the world, and it couldn't fill me. Man's empty praise, the treasure that failed, never enough. You came along, put me back together, and every desire is now satisfied here in your love. Oh, there's nothing better than you. Oh, there's nothing better than you. Oh, there's nothing, nothing is better. I'm not afraid to show you my weakness, my failures and flaws. Lord, you've seen them all, and you still call me friend. 'Cause the God of the mountain is the God of the valley, and there's not a place your mercy and grace won't find me again. Oh, there's nothing better than you. Oh, there's nothing better than you. Oh, there's nothing, nothing is better than you. Yeah. Oh, there's garden. You turn bones into armies. You turn seas into highways. You're the only one who can. You're the only one who can. Oh, there's nothing better than you. Oh, there's nothing better than you. Oh, there's
Lord, we acknowledge you as the one true living God. Help us to learn from your word this morning. In your name we pray. Amen.
You ever get so caught up in worship that you forget you have a job to do? I kind of forgot that right now. There is nothing better. There is nothing better. There is nothing better. Nothing than Jesus Christ. There is nothing. We can go home right now, literally, because there is indeed nothing that is better. I do want to mention real quick, just if anybody is not into writing checks or don't carry checks or cash along with them, if you want to give and you want to give right now to Turkish Connections International, the website is turkishconnections.org. And you can go to turkishconnections.org, and there's a button in the top, and it says donate. And you can go straight to donate and do all that there online if you want to. Like I said, you can write a check to us, but if you want it to get there faster, you can write it straight to Turkish Connections International. We'll collect those, and we'll make sure they get to where they go. My good friend Rich Freeman started this ministry so many years ago and has planted multiple churches in Turkey and has a few in that southeast region. So, but again, he can turn graves into gardens, right? Bones into armies. And so he can take this and still he is glorified through it. Amen? Amen. Question for today. Does anyone collect comic books? One of you. Really? No comic books? Is that like of the devil? And that's why? No, I'm just kidding. You know, you watch movies. Oh, yeah, you don't collect comic books because you watch movies about comic book characters. That's what you do now, right? Maybe when you were younger, you collected comic books. A few? Okay, cool. I wasn't into collecting comic books myself, but my dad was. In fact, my dad even had the second edition of Action Comics. Now, I don't know if you know what Action Comics are, but it's Superman, right? It was like the early Superman ones, and he had the second edition for, again, that's for us non-comic book peeps, that's where Superman can be found. Sadly, his mom was indifferent to his collecting of comic books and was cleaning his room one day, and yeah. Anyways, but what did survive, though, from my grandmother's cleaning, was a large collection of Justice League of America comic books, which I found exploring the garage. I found them, and I started devouring them. That's where you have all of the superheroes together, for those of you who don't know, right? Superman, Batman, Wonder Woman, Flash, Aquaman, Cyborg, Hawkman, need I go on, right? The pattern, though, in these comic books, I tell you, it was always the same. Like, I could write these comic books easily because it's always the same story. Okay, so bad guys come onto the scene. Some villain or villainous organization like the Legion of Doom would come in, and they would wreak havoc on something. They would kidnap someone. They would find some weakness in one of the superheroes or whatever. And then they would, you know, thwart the Justice League, and it would look like everything was ended and life was over on planet Earth and throughout the universe until the heroes would rise from the ashes and save the day. They would come in and just rule everything, right? It was good versus evil, that classic story. And good is supposed to win, right? Good wins. We know that, and that's how it's supposed to be. Until you start getting into our times nowadays, it seems like evil tends to win a little bit, does it not? And I'm sure Habakkuk was thinking about this as well as he's writing his prophetic book, which really is a question of God. God, do you hear me? He asked last week, right? We began this new minor prophet of Habakkuk, and he asked that question, does God hear me? And what he received from the Lord wasn't really an answer that he was looking for. Right? It wasn't what he wanted to hear, as we'll see again today, but it did show us that God is sovereign, that God is all-knowing, and that God graciously reveals exactly what we need and when we need it. Okay? Now today, Habakkuk's going to ask a follow-up question, is God just? Or why does evil seem to go unpunished? Closely related might be that age-old question, if God is so good, Why does he allow so much evil to happen? It is a question that has gone down through the millennia, and people have offered many answers to. I'm not going to answer the whole question today, that's for sure. I want to point to exactly what Habakkuk is dealing with today. But before we do so, we need to pray and ask God's blessing on our time. Lord, we thank you that you are good. There is nothing better than you. And we do know that you turn graves into gardens, and you make highways out of oceans and seas, and you are so good to us. And you are, Lord, yet we see things happen. We've seen this tragedy of this earthquake in Turkey and Syria, and we see what's going on in the Ukraine and other parts of the world, and there seems to be injustice that's being done, and not to mention just individual acts of injustice that might even be done to us. But God, we're going to trust you today, that you are good and you're bigger than our questions. You have the answers. And sometimes you ask us to just do that, to just put our trust in you, to realize that there is nothing better than you. Lord, open our eyes today to see your word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Okay, so we're going to look at Habakkuk chapter 1. So if you'll turn with me there, we're going to be in verse 12 of Habakkuk. Let me see if I have the page marked, because, yeah. So Habakkuk chapter 1, beginning in verse 12 and following. Now, again, like I said, Habakkuk gave this complaint last week, asked this question of God. God, do you really hear me? Do you hear my cries? You see our people treating unjustly, and even our people acting unjustly towards one another. You know, what's going on? God, can you step in? Can you hear me? Can you answer my prayer? And now he asks this follow-up question, and he's troubled because of God's answer, right? What was God's answer to his question? I'm sending the Chaldeans. So he asks a question, God, do you hear me? And God says, yes, I do, and I'm sending the Chaldeans, who, as we saw last week, were a pretty bad group of people, and we'll see that even more as we go ahead today. And so he's questioning, well, okay, you're sending this group of bad guys to beat up some other bad guys, but those bad guys aren't as bad as the bad guys that you're sending to beat up the bad, lots of bad guys. But he's troubled, right? That how could you, God, how could you use these Chaldeans, this pagan nation, to accomplish your purposes? But this is how he starts this question. I want you to read with me verse 12. It says, are you not from everlasting, O Lord my God, my Holy One? We shall not die. O Lord, you have ordained them as a judgment. And you, O rock, have established them for reproof. I'm going to stop right there, because the first question that Habakkuk asks here is not actually a question, but it's a statement. It's a statement about who God is. Remember last week I said God does not owe us explanations. What he gives us is revelation. And these are things that he has revealed to Habakkuk about himself, right? God is an eternal God. He is from everlasting, rounded off by the statement that says, then we shall not die. And we're going to deal with the meat in the middle in a little bit, right? Habakkuk knows, though, that this is an essential part of God's nature. Some translations then have where it says, you shall not die, referring to God, but that's based on some later rabbinic traditions and most likely to make it easier to understand. But the manuscripts and the Septuagint say we. And now how can it say we? It's because we know God is eternal. Habakkuk can say then your people are as well, because your promises are true, right? We can trust in those promises. Now the meat in the middle, as with the first complaint, reminds us that Habakkuk has a relationship with this God. Look at the middle. Oh Lord, my God, my Holy One. He's able to call God, my Holy One, right? This is a relationship that he has with him. And then Habakkuk recognizes the sovereignty of the Lord once again. And look, he even says, you've raised this people up. You've done it. You can use the Chaldeans as judgment against Israel. The rock, if you can smell what he's cooking, has established them for reproof. In other words, God has ordained them to be his agent. What's the point of all this? Why does Habakkuk start this way? Well, he has to start by revealing what he knows to be true about God. Because this question is so deep. And I think sometimes we miss this. This question is so deep because it's talking about how we relate to other people. We're supposed to relate to other people in justice, right? And so he has to point to this, what is true about God. God is eternal. This relationship that they have, he's holy, and his sovereignty. And James Montgomery Boyce said, even if Habakkuk could not understand all that God did, he would have found comfort in knowing that, for example, he served the everlasting God. You see, how many of us have looked at what's happened in the world and go, what is going on? Or maybe something tragic has happened to us as individuals. God, where are you in that? Habakkuk knows who God is. He's basing his response on the revelation of God rather than this explanation or even this expectation, right? And so he starts that way. Either that or he's just buttering him up for what he's about to say. I'm just kidding. But with that in mind, let's move on to the rest of his question. So look at verse 13 through 17. He says, you who are of purer eyes than to see evil and cannot look at wrong, why do you idly look at traitors and remain silent when the wicked swallows up the man more righteous than he? You make mankind like the fish of the sea, like crawling things that have no ruler. He brings all of them up with a hook, and he drags them out with his net, and he gathers them in his dragnet, and so he rejoices and is glad, and therefore he sacrifices to his net and makes offerings to his dragnet, for by them he lives in luxury and his food is rich. Is he then to keep on emptying his net and mercilessly killing nations forever? You see, Habakkuk has looked at what's going on and what God has promised through the Chaldeans, and he's like, oh boy, I don't know about this. I don't know about this. One more appeal he makes to the purity and holiness of God. Habakkuk asks the key question, is God just? How can you, an all-powerful God, a completely holy God, allow such evil to go unchecked? You know, like last week, he accuses God of kind of standing idly by. How can you idly look at traitors, remaining silent, twiddling your thumbs, if you will, while the wicked, literally, it says, swallow up the righteous? David Baker, another commentator, said, what astonishes Habakkuk is that God is silent at this new unjust turn of events. He ought, in the light of his character, as understood by Habakkuk, to be doing something to right them. And he's not, seemingly, right? In verse 14, he complains that you have made mankind to be like fish or things that crawl, right? These don't have rulers. There's nothing to protect them from predators in the ocean, right? They're just little fish and things that crawl. The implication is that these Babylonians, these Chaldeans, are going to be too much for the people of Israel. We will be helpless against them. In other words, that's excessive punishment. And how is that just in any way? In verse 15, he gets really specific, and now we know for sure he's speaking of Babylon. That's the he there. Babylon was known to literally put hooks in the noses of their, you know, people they held captive and to drag them by that, often ripping them out. That's not a pretty picture, is it? Okay? Picture that one, like I said, quite painful and humiliating treatment, if you ask me. There's also pictures of prisoners being caught like fish in a net. And then they say that they even sacrifice to those nets and make offerings to their dragnets. What's that about? Basically, he's saying they have so much pride in their accomplishment that they set up their tools of warfare as idols or gods. They worship their nets, okay? Boy, that doesn't sound like us, does it? These things allow them to live in luxury, to eat rich foods, to get cases of gout. No, I'm just kidding. Oh, man. Thanks, God. Long story short, Habakkuk is troubled. And we can sense that. We can see, can you see his anguish? Can you see where he's just crying out to God here? Like, what's going on, God? How long? God, how can you allow such an evil nation to judge your people and get away with it? I know we aren't the best, but those guys, really? How can they just keep filling up their nets, emptying them out? How long will they be allowed to mercilessly kill? Forever? He says, will they be allowed to do this forever? Is God just? And just in case we want to rip Habakkuk a new one, haven't we asked some of those similar questions? Like, God, 28,000 people? Shootings, violence, etc. seem to be in the news every day, or especially if we've been the victims of a crime and have not seen justice prevail. God, when will it stop? David G. Firth says, for Habakkuk, these were not theoretical issues for armchair philosophizing. They were real issues of the world in which he lived, where injustice was rampant in Judah. And we're told at the beginning of chapter 2, verse 1, this. It says, I will take my stand at my watchpost. I will station myself on the tower, and I will look out to see what he will say to me and what I will answer concerning my complaint. Like a good soldier, this prophet Habakkuk makes his stand at the watchpost. He's waiting for orders. He's waiting to hear what the king is going to say to him, waiting for God's answer. And this struck me because it shows that Habakkuk is serious about receiving an answer from God. And it's not easy to be in that waiting place, though, right? How many of us just move ahead of God? It's like, God, you're not answering my prayer, so I'm just going to do what I do. But he's waiting, right, for God to answer. It's not a flippant question. It's not an irreverent question either. He's persistently waiting upon the Lord in faith. And so God answers. And here's what God answers. Let's look at verse 2 and 3 of chapter 2. And the Lord answered me, write the vision, make it plain on tablets so that he may run who reads it. For still the vision awaits its appointed time. It hastens to the end. It will not lie. If it seems slow, wait for it. It will surely come. It will not delay. Anybody ever do that? Wait for it. You can almost hear him saying that. How many of you know that there are three answers to prayer? Yes? No? And maybe? Is there any maybes with God? No, it's yes, no, or wait. Now, we don't like to hear the answer no. We know that already, right? Sometimes we even feel it's harder to hear the answer wait. Because that means we have to wait. And we don't like to wait. One of the brightest minds captured it this way. See if you can guess who. You can get so confused that you'll start into race down long-winged roads at breaknecking pace and grind on for miles across weirdish wild space, headed, I fear, towards a most useless place, the waiting place. For people just waiting, waiting for a train to go or a bus to come or a plane to go or the mail to come or the rain to go or the phone to ring or the snow to snow or the waiting around for a yes or no, or waiting for their hair to grow. Everyone is just waiting, waiting for the fish to bite. Have you ever waited for that before? I don't do that. Or waiting for the wind to fly a kite, or waiting around for Friday night, or waiting perhaps for their Uncle Jake. Dang, Uncle Jake, always late. Or a pot to boil, or a better break, or a string of pearls, or a pair of pants, or a wig with curls, or another chance. Everyone is just waiting. Anybody know who that was? Dr. Seuss, Theodore Geisel. The waiting place, but he goes on to say in his book, Oh, the Places You'll Go, he goes on to say the waiting place is not for you. He encourages his readers that somehow they will escape. And did you know he wrote that for a graduation commencement? That book? For Habakkuk and for the people of Israel, that day would come, but until then they would have to stay in that waiting place. Notice in verse 2, God gives Habakkuk this prophetic vision. He says, write it down. Write it on the tablets, symbolizing its permanence, reminding him of the law that was given to Moses. When Moses wrote down the law, or when God told Moses to write down the law, he literally used that word tablets like a bajillion times to make sure that he understood the permanence of this word, right? Write it on tablets. The one who reads it, he says, will run. Now, what does that mean? Maybe this is a messenger running to take the message to the public, or might be the one who hears the message, because you might run a run, too, if you hear this message that God is going to say. Verse 3 tells us that they have to await the appointed time, the time that God has appointed for the judgment to commence. John Watts remarks, the verses stressed there will be an answer, and God will not be silent forever. However fast or slow, it will come in God's perfect time. Peter reminds his audience in 2 Peter 3:8 through 9. Says, don't overlook this one fact, beloved, that with the Lord, one day is 1,000 years. How many of you heard that before? With the Lord, one day is 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is one day. The Lord is not slow to fulfill his promise, as some count slowness, but is patient toward you, not wishing that any should perish, but that all should reach repentance. How many of us have been praying for our friends who don't know Christ to come to Christ? Sienna, I see that hand, girl. Get it up there. Me too. But sometimes that waiting is so hard, is it not? Because we love our family. We love our friends. We don't want to see injustice happen. We don't want to see the wicked prevail. We want to see God come in on your white horse and just fix everything. And one day he will. If it seems slow, wait for it. Wait for it. And then we get one of the most definitive statements in the Old Testament of the gospel. Look with me, please. Verse 4 and 5. It says, behold, his soul is puffed up. It's not upright within him. But the righteous shall live by faith. Moreover, wine is a traitor, an arrogant man who is never at rest. His greed is as wide as Sheol. Like death, he has never enough. He gathers for himself all nations and collects as his own all peoples. But I want to go back to verse 4, we have this statement of contrast. The nation or the king, his soul, it could be either of Babylon, has a soul that is puffed up, that isn't upright. One with a puffed up soul thinks quite highly of himself, relying on his own strength, and it's in contrast to the righteous one who will live by faith. Now, you may recognize this statement. How many of you have heard that before? The righteous shall live by his faith. You may recognize that statement. Boyce said, this is a great text. It could even be called the great text of the Bible. To understand it is to understand the Christian gospel and the Christian life. In fact, this phrase held so much meaning for Martin Luther that it became basically the calling card or the motto of the Protestant Reformation. Sola fide. Only by faith. Take a few moments to look at the passages in the New Testament that quote this. Romans chapter 1, in Paul's great kind of theological treatise or his Christology, right, salvation. He quotes in Romans chapter 1, we'll just do 16 and 17. He says, for I am not ashamed of the gospel. For it is the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes, to the Jew first, and also to the Greek. For in it, the righteousness of God is revealed from faith for faith, as it is written, the righteous shall live by faith. So hold on to that for a second, because I'm going to read the other one as well. Galatians chapter 3, Paul also uses this same passage. Look at verse 11 through 13. Galatians 3, 11 through 13. It says this, "Now it is evident that no one is justified before God by the law, for the righteous shall live by faith. But the law is not of faith, rather the one who does them shall live by them. Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law by becoming a curse for us, for it is written, 'Cursed is everyone who hanged on a tree,' or 'is hanged on a tree,' so that in Christ Jesus the blessing of Abraham might come to the Gentiles," praise God, "so that we might receive the promised Spirit through faith." Okay. Now, in each of these passages, Paul is interpreting this Old Testament prophecy of the righteous shall live by faith as talking about salvation. Okay, as talking about salvation, saving faith, which comes not through the law, but through the grace of God as revealed in Christ. It is faith in Christ by which we become righteous, having the righteousness of Christ imputed upon us, thus making us right with God. Okay, you just got a crash course in imputed righteousness and justification by faith right there. And the emphasis is on saving faith. Now, okay, is that what Habakkuk is talking about here? Well, ultimately, we know God saves. Amen. But there's another aspect of faith, right? And the author of Hebrews picks up on this. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 36 through 39. Says, "For you have need of endurance, so that when you have done the will of God, you may receive what is promised. For yet a little while, and the coming one will come and will not delay. But my righteous one shall live by faith. And if he shrinks back, my soul has no pleasure in him. But we are not of those who shrink back and are destroyed, but of those who have faith and preserve their souls." Now, here the emphasis is on the fact that those who have the righteousness of Jesus by faith, now followers of Christ, ought to live then by what? Faith. One commentator said, "It will take faith to wait patiently for God's plan to unfold, but the righteous believe that God will accomplish it." And it is this sort of faith that trusts the Lord even when he's forced to wait in a dark place, in the darkness, for the light to shine, that God will act justly. God will act justly, and that's exactly what the Lord is saying to Habakkuk. And then we have this weird moreover statement, which the textual note says the meaning of is uncertain. So yeah, don't you love that? Long story short, the wealth, or it could be translated as wealth or wine, represents this like luxurious life of the Chaldeans, which we saw before. They were living lives of luxury. And as we know, luxury never satisfied. His greed, it says, is as wide as Sheol, right? Sheol was the place of the dead, which was never, ever filled up. There was always room. David first says, just as the grave is never satisfied, right? So also the Chaldeans will never find satisfaction. Such a life is ultimately destructive. But once again, let me point out that the righteous shall live by faith. Okay. And as they live by faith, what they were waiting for was what the rest of chapter 2 of Habakkuk reveals. Because the answer to the question, is God just, is definitively yes. He is a just God. It is part of his nature to be just. In fact, he cannot not be just. And so he is just. And then we get this series of woes, or taunt songs, if you will. God making clear the reasons why the Chaldeans are in trouble. Even though God is going to use them for his purposes in helping Israel and Judah to wake up, It doesn't mean they are free from any consequences of the things that they are going to do, right? And so they will face justice as well, the punishment that they will endure. And sprinkled in are some truths about the glory and majesty of God. So we're just going to touch on them briefly, because we could spend a whole month of Sundays on the rest of this as well, but we'll just touch on them briefly. Chapter 2, verse 6 through 8. Shall not all these take up their taunt against him with scoffing and riddles for him and say, woe to him who heaps up what is not his own for how long and loads himself with pledges? Will not your debtors suddenly arise and those awake who will make you tremble? And then you will be spoil for them because you have plundered many nations. All the remnants of the people shall plunder you for the blood of man and violence to the earth, to cities and all who dwell in them. Basically, what we see here is the Chaldeans are just plain greedy. They want everything. They want the world. They want the whole world. They want to wrap it all up in their pocket. It's their bar of chocolate. Give it to them now. No? Man, you guys, we really are waiting for the game today. Man. They heap up the spoils of war. They hoard things that do not belong to them. They plunder the nation. So what's the woe here? Well, eventually it says the debtors will flip the script and Chaldea, or the Babylonians, will be the spoil. The remnant will pool their strength and plunder them. And we do know eventually that that happens and Babylon is done. And then we have verse 9 through 11. Woe to him who gets evil gain for his house, to set his nest on high, to be safe from the reach of harm. You have devised shame for your house by cutting off many peoples. You have forfeited your life. For the stone will cry out from the wall and the beam from the woodwork respond. This one might be a little bit harder to see, but it's closely related to their greed. It says they continue to amass wealth. Think of it like they're building this nest egg. Like that's the imagery that we see there. They put it up in a nest on high, out of the reach of harm, okay, if you will, that was inaccessible to the surrounding nations. And in doing so, it says they're actually acting unjustly. It's evil gain. It's shameful gain. What's the woe? He says, what was plundered, those things that you stole, that you got in an unrighteous manner, will eventually speak out against you. They will be a witness against you. In verse 12, woe to him who builds a town with blood, founds a city on iniquity. Behold, it is not from the Lord of hosts that peoples labor merely for fire and nations weary themselves for nothing, for the earth will be filled with the knowledge of the glory of the Lord as the waters cover the sea. Here it's clear that Babylon is condemned for their violence. We're told that they build towns on blood and iniquity. Now what's the woe here? This one's easy. This is low-hanging fruit right here. The woe is that God is in control. That God will cause nations to rise and to fall. And ultimately, it says, the entire earth will be filled with the knowledge of the glory of the Lord. And every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, some to their eternal glory and some not. Verse 15. Woe to him who makes his neighbors drink. You pour out your wrath and make them drunk in order to gaze at their nakedness. You will have your fill of shame instead of glory. Drink yourself and show your uncircumcision. The cup in the Lord's right hand will come around to you, and utter shame will come upon your glory. The violence done to Lebanon will overwhelm you, as will the destruction of the beasts that terrified them, for the blood of man and violence to the earth, to cities, and all who dwell in them. There's woe to the seducers. This is just plain shameful. Acts of violence then lead to more violence, and this time of a sexual nature. We have a mixed crowd here today. I won't get into the specifics, but you can see. What's the woe? Woe is that once again the tables will be turned. Babylon will be ashamed and embarrassed. Their glory will be turned to shame when the cup of God's wrath will be poured out upon. And then the final woe, verse 18. What profit is an idol when its maker has shaped it, a metal image, a teacher of lies, for its maker trusts in his own creation when he makes speechless idols? Woe to him who says to a wooden thing, awake, to a silent stone, arise. Can this teach? Behold, it's overlaid with gold and silver, but there is no breath in it at all. But the Lord is in his holy temple. Let all the earth keep silence before him. See, God saved the best for last. Or should I say the worst for last? Idolatry. In this case, it's literal idols made of metal, wood, or stone, which the people would set up in the place of God and worship. What's the woe? These idols, even if covered with gold and silver, have no life in them. They have no power in them. They cannot speak. They have no speech at all. But what do we know? The Lord is in his holy temple. Where the idols have no life, God is the source of all life. Where the idols have no power, God is the Almighty God. Where the idols cannot speak at all, God tells you, be quiet and listen to me. Because I am in my holy temple. I am the living God. I am the Almighty God. I am the God who speaks, and so the earth had better shut up and listen. So the answer to the question, is God just? Absolutely. Absolutely, he is just. He justifies those who have faith in Christ. Amen? Amen. He brings justice to bear on those who are unjust. In his perfect timing, which may not be our own. And those who wait upon the Lord and live by faith will see that. So if you're in a place today where you're like Habakkuk and you've looked around at the world around you and all you see is crime and injustice and wickedness and immorality and evil, know that God does not like. In fact, we're told in Scripture, we just looked at this today in our Sunday school class, that God hates evil. Know that. And he will not stand idly by twiddling his thumbs forever, but his wrath will be poured out on those who don't know him. But for you and I who have made that decision to follow Christ, to place our faith in him, we have the righteousness of Christ. And we can stand assured of that fact. Is he just? Yes, he is. So what do we do? Two things. We trust in his perfect timing. It's perfect. It may not be what we think is right. It may not be the timing that we want, because we want things to happen yesterday. But God knows all. And in his perfect timing, it will come to pass. So we need to trust in that. Trust in that. And then secondly, as we are trusting in him and his perfect timing, what are we called to live by? Live by faith. Live by faith. The righteous will live by faith. Well, there's nothing, Lord, better than you. Sometimes we look out on the world and all we see are graves. And what you're doing is you're cultivating a garden. Sometimes we look out on the world and all we see is this ocean or sea that we cannot cross, and it seems so deep and so wide, and yet you're making a highway through it. Sometimes we even look in our own lives and all we see is ashes because of the choices that we've made, because of the choices that others have made around us, and yet you are creating something beautiful. And you're the only one who can. Because you are perfectly just. Lord, help us to wait patiently and to live by faith. And to you be all the glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's rise together and sing. But to his name be the glory because of his love and his faithfulness. And if we don't cry out, the rocks are going to cry out. And so we better cry out, you guys. We better. Let a little while, yet a little while, and the coming one will come, and he will not delay, but my righteous one shall live by faith. And if he shrinks back, my soul has no pleasure in him. But we are not of those who shrink back and are destroyed, but of those who have faith and preserve their souls. So go forth today and live by faith. God bless you guys. Have a great day. Be safe and have fun. See you guys. Watching at home, we love you as well.